is, it's wonderful to see you all here, and God has brought some unusual gatherings. Every time He gathers up His people, people come from everywhere, and you're going to have a chance to get to know somebody new and meet somebody new being here today. But the bad news is, summer's over. And Ron and I have been making a little more relaxed atmosphere out of everything we've been doing in worship. And if you want us to keep it that way, you better talk to us. Otherwise, we're going to go back to what we have normally been doing. And we're glad David Tranquin, he's telling me that I need to quit wearing ties in morning worship. We'll see how that goes. I want to ask you, I started out this summer saying to you that I had seen the face of Jesus in many places that surprised me in the last several weeks before summer began. In the face of an old man that came off the interstate, in the faces of some children that we had helped, in the faces of several people who came by the church just to say, I'm so thankful for my church, and let me tell you what God's doing in my life. I've heard that in so many places that I challenge you to think this summer, where will you see Jesus this summer? So I'm going to ask you now, everywhere, wherever you are, to give me some very brief responses. I don't need any sermons, because I've already got that one ready for you. I just need some brief responses. Where have you seen the face of Jesus this summer?
In the faces of the elderly, in the rest homes, and the homeless.
Francis, you have been there too. If you hadn't gone as constantly as you have, you wouldn't have seen it.
Yes,
Ruth. And you're one of the faces in which she saw the face of Jesus. Who else? Sonny, are you raising your hand? You're just scratching your nose.
Been thrilled to see the face of Jesus in the work. Of course, it's one of our Christian ministry, which I've been able to be a part of since the first of the year. And then, of course, to see his grace in my own life, in where he's led me.
In working in a great opportunity, Sweat Swarm of our Christian ministry. Diana. No, sir. sermon now.
I know that they have talked to Mozart. To amen what Judy said, I have the privilege of tying a marriage knot for a beautiful young couple way up on the upper reaches of Greens Creek yesterday, surrounded by the beautiful mountains under a 205-year-old oak tree. And it was awesome.
For two people promise their lives to each other and ask them how to listen. Matt?
I saw the face of Jesus when we were wanting to redo our kitchen. And all this coming, we had a little doubt, you know, how we're going to raise this money.
We'll never get it. I heard it, Matt. They said, we'll never make this happen.
And I saw his face when all that came to pass.
It's accomplished, it's done, and it's pledged. It's not paid for, but it's pledged.
I saw the face of Jesus this summer at Michael with two tomato. We live, face of Jesus and Mike and two tomato. We live in our missionary house and live through all the construction that's going on up there today. And their beautiful granddaughter that they have, the soft joy that they're being.
Mike and Julie, you've been a blessing to us. I see you all out there. I'll mention a few things if anybody else has anything to mention. Bill?
Was visiting a man who's in the hospital critically ill. And the doctor got some really devastating news, and the conversation between the husband and wife just a pledge of their love for each other and faith in Christ, just that Jesus is there.
Several of the young people told me that as they were painting faces in the Sour Festival, that they were sort of amazed to look at the eyes of little children and seem to feel like they were looking. Amazing to hear that. I have seen the face of Jesus in several little camp kids that I had the privilege to see through Ron and Danny and everybody at work in the camp out there. And then also yesterday, driving up to the camp, I saw a big collection of about 8 staffers that worked for Ron all summer long. And they just love that camp. And they said to me, can't believe some of the changes that happened in people's lives in this summer at camp. That's wonderful to hear. Rita and I attended Martin Luther King weekend in Moncrief, but the interesting thing about it was a powerful experience of continuing the conversation about racism. And we sat in a person's home who said, yeah, I was here 50 years ago when we voted invite Martin Luther King to Moncrief. He said, the conference center, which is full of a whole bunch of church folks, said this is not a wise idea, and they voted it down. But it went to the big group in the area-wide bunch of Presbyterians, and they voted it in, and it became a powerful, important experience in this area to hear Martin Luther King 50 years ago, and then last week. All right, you will see the face of Jesus if you're looking. John Pelt, I see a finger. Now's the time to do it. Thank you, John. Here's the point. You will see the face of Jesus in the face of other people, both those who love him and those who need him. So I invite you to take just a minute to turn and greet each other, and then we'll start our next scene.
Thank you.
is our time to pray together. There are many concerns in all of our lives. There's a concern to offer the word of thanks that we sometimes just don't get around to. I want to give you time to offer thanks for the good things that God has done in your life. And I pray we can bow and offer your thanks to God. Lord, we're here this morning, and that's a lot to be grateful for. We're thankful for the strength that we have to be here as we think of so many others whose strength is failing. We're grateful for hours and ask that you would use us, Lord, as instruments of your peace, that we might take out to others what we have, just the simple reassurance that you are the Lord and we can trust you. We're thankful for a church, a gathering of people that come together to seek you. We ask, O Lord, that you help us to open up our hearts to see you all around us, pouring out your grace and power in the wonder of creation, a wonderful place, not a place. To see you in the faces of people all around us who support us and encourage us and teach us and lead us and show us the way, and who've done things long before we got here to make it possible for us to have strength in life. We're thankful for them, O Lord. We offer our thanks and ask that we would be people who would be planting trees now that we won't ever find the shade from, but brave enough to plant a tree now that will shade our future generation. We're thankful for our church, what it stands for, that we're a witness for your grace and your power, and no matter what's going on in this world, that we truly believe, O Lord, because of your love for us, that you are sovereign in all things. You have the final word. You bless and keep your own. You encourage us to be good servants, good stewards, and good witnesses of your grace that never fails. We're thankful for so many blessings that we receive. But most of all, Lord, we pray you would make of our lives blessings to others so that we could be true to the wonder and the power of the God that we know who never fails us. It's in his name we pray.
Thank you.
let me find the man that God has already appointed to be here. I certainly don't want to see Bill Henderson leave, but I know his time will be up soon. So, and also, we pray for the workers at the fair. I've been passing out the paper asking for food for the fair people. And thank you so much. I've seen the face of Jesus in all of you. And thank you so much for the time. And offering to send the sandwiches and fruit, the chips and the fruit, yeah, and the desserts. And we usually have a lot of chips, so don't sign up for that. Because we get 36 of that. But thank you so much for praying for me as I was speaking, and I'll be off this year. But thank you so much for all your love and your care. And I feel so at home here, and thank you for all you do for this church.
And together, join us singing Paris for Jesus. Exciting and strong and uplifting and joyful church.
to the point that they get a little in trouble from time to time. Slip over to one side and just be all full of just excitement, and he had to bring them back and remember, help remind them of why they're excited. And that's what this verse of Scripture is about. Beginning with the 14th verse in 2 Corinthians 5. For it is Christ's love that has drawn us and drives us. Because we're convinced that this one died for all of us, and therefore all of us have died and have finished with the troubles of this world. And he died for all of us, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for us and was raised again to new life. So from now on, we don't see anybody through the eyes of the world. Though we once saw Christ that way, we do no longer. And therefore, here's the verse. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, and the new has come. All of this is from God, who made peace with us and drew us through Jesus Christ. And he gives us the ministry of making peace with others. So if he was in Christ, he's a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. Pray with me just a moment, please, as we come to this time of Scripture. Lord, most all of us have come to you wanting some kind of change in our lives. But then the negotiations have begun. And we think we're supposed to negotiate with you about how much we're supposed to change, or how much we're willing to change and still walk with you. Forgive us, for this is not something you call us to negotiate about. You called us to change our lives. So help us now, Lord, to hear your call for that change. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I've been hearing some things that you need to hear about. Some things that have the word attached to them that makes it absolutely clear what they say and what they promise is this. This stuff will change your life. You heard a lot of that this last couple of weeks. You turn on any of the news or anything else on TV, you hear a lot of things. Well, there is a new medicine for people who have dying nerve endings on their feet. Now, many of you have told me about that kind of thing, foot drop or dragging feet or that kind of thing. Well, I'm feeling a lot of sympathy for you because I'm beginning to feel some of that too. But here we have this new offer. It will change your life. You take this little pill and it will change your life. Thank goodness for the good news of TV commercials. We have the privilege of changing our lives. But wait, there's a whole lot more. I've heard about 12 or 14 in the last 2 weeks. I'll list a few of them. A blood pressure medicine. It will change your life. I'm sure it would. Then there's treatment for diabetes, psoriasis, and arthritis. It's all there. It will change your life if you can just get it. Then there's the way they pick on some of us who are over 60. Senior adult medical insurance, it will change your life. Reverse mortgages on your house. Charter communications that will bundle all the things that you call your necessary gadgets. It will change your life. And then there is dandruff shampoo. Will change your life. And dental repairs on those broken and twisted teeth and some of that nasty yellowing that comes from those of us who drink a lot of coffee. But Phillips milk of magnesia. It will change your life. That's what the word is. And then there's natural gas. And finally, the animal rescue. I can hardly wait to get started. How can we resist all these things that have changed our lives? The pundits and wags say to us that the only thing that is constant in life is change. Do you like change? I love change. And so I'm excited about getting into all these things that have offered to change my life. Well, do you like change? Do you like change? Even to hear the word lets you know that there's something kind of creeping underneath the surface that's going to be offered to you. There are two ways to respond to changes, aren't there? One of them is that we embrace it completely. We accept it. We say, oh, good, things are going to change. We're not afraid of change, and we look positively upon it, and we gladly accept that it's inevitable. Or, on the other hand, that other option is to resist it. We deny it has any value. We've already worked out our plans. We know our system. We know how it works. Don't disturb me. And so I don't like the word change. I prefer the status quo. I've got my mind made up. Don't disturb me with facts. Where are you on this continuum? Accepting it or rejecting it? Embracing it when you hear it or resisting it? Or looking at things with a noticeably critical eye or automatically saying, no way, leave me alone, my mind's made up. Well, there is another approach. If you think either one of those are too extreme, there's another approach, and we Christians have perfected it. It is praising what you hear on Sunday and resisting it on Wednesday. We can say one thing and then we do another. At least we can keep them guessing if we keep doing all that. People will get so confused if we keep praising it on Sunday and then do something else during the week. They'll be so confused they'll quit asking us to change. It's a good and a subtle plan. We Christians have perfected it. And we can keep going back to doing things as usual because we're pretty comfortable. We like the way things are. The problem is that that's not the way Jesus was. Jesus said we had one purpose in life. One reason we've been given life and placed on this planet. He was challenged by a wealthy young man who came and said, how do you figure out this thing you're offering called salvation? And he said, you have one purpose in life, and that is one command to follow. Only, it's very simple, and that is to love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your strength and all your mind, and then to love your neighbor in the same way that you take care of and love yourself. Now, if you try to do that halfway, you're going to find yourself in deep trouble. You either do it all the way or not at all. It's either total new life, or it becomes an albatross over your neck, and it will give you the worst case of guilt you've ever had, and it will linger all your life. But people are always pushing us to do something that's generally uncomfortable or disturbing to our lives. And a lot of us fall into the category of saying, you know, I just need to resist all this talk about change. Even the word sends chills up my spine. I don't know about you. But there can be two different kinds of chill. One chill is, ugh, don't bother me. I don't want to have to hear that again. Or it could be the chill of hope. Oh, maybe there's a possibility that somebody has an answer to the complications and the problems that I face. So I'm really very serious about asking you, when you hear the word change, what do you think? Where are you on this whole continuum? And I have to ask you this because I have heard this question or talked about as I questioned three different people on the streets of Black Mountain in the last 2 weeks. And they were asking about First Baptist in lieu of change. One said, do you think they are changing up there? One said, do you think that they will ever change up there? And somebody said, is it really possible that change might happen? Now, it was a question I really wanted to answer in all three of these conversations. I wanted desperately to affirm with excitement what I see happening in your lives and in your groups and in your fellowship and in your relationships and in all your forms of service and in what we do here in worship. But the truth is, these folks need to be asking you, don't they? They need to be asking you. And they need to be getting their answers from you. And all three of these people that I had these conversations with are people who have no church. I wish they could be asking you. So let's hear again this scripture's affirmation that says that when you're Christ, you're changed. You're an absolutely new creation. All the old stuff is gone and all the new stuff has already come. And the greatest life change has already been accomplished. That's what the scripture says. That if you are in Christ, if you're a person of faith, if you've given your life to Him in simple faith and trust, then a change that's phenomenal, that's changed, has already occurred. Something is already different in you. What does this really mean? I think, first of all, we have to acknowledge that when we're in Christ, we live in a culture of trust. And what that means is that the gospel's good news has changed our dependence on life out there as we know it. Politics don't control us. Systems don't control us. The skills or the leadership that we find in our world don't control us. Even our own health doesn't control us. And we ourselves don't control everything. We have been changed to a confidence in the Lord God. We have heard in the scriptures that He is the Lord of life, that He is the Lord of heaven and earth. He is the God and Father of the Lord Jesus Christ who was raised from the dead. Jesus said that our God is just and fair in all of His dealings, faithful and never, never failing. That God is holy and perfect in all of His ways. And we know that God is all-powerful and all-knowing and all-present and all-loving. That's the message of the Scriptures. God created this world. This is His world. And God is in control. And yet we have this argument with God, don't we? Because God has given us a free will, a chance to shape our world and our own lives according to how we really want to, as we negotiate with Him about how much of His change we really want. We have a hard time in learning soon enough what it really means is to act like Christ. Is to override some of the automatic reactions that we have toward people and toward circumstances and toward politics and toward leaders. We have a hard time overriding our automatic reactions there. We have a hard time convincing ourselves that we ought to act like Christ. We ought to respect other people. And that we ought to work with wisdom as opposed to opinions. And that we should have compassion for all people. And that in everything we do, we ought to be working at showing the grace of Christ. These are the working commodities of the world that God has created. They're no secret. And they're not for sale. They are freely given in Christ. If any person is in Christ, he is a new creation, a changed person. We live in a culture of trust. It changes the way we look at and think about the world. We have this little thing down underneath us, no matter how bad things are going, we have this little thing down underneath that's called joy. And nobody can take that away from us. It's joyful to know that we're never alone. The presence of God is in our lives. It's joyful to know that no matter how deep our troubles can go, we know that there's somebody there alongside of us, partnering with us, that can make things untangle and get in the right direction. It's joyful to know that no matter how much turmoil we might face in life, that He gives peace. And it's there for us. And then it's joyful to know that we have opportunity because God is opening doors for us all the time. That makes a great and strong people, doesn't it? When they have a joy that can't be taken from them. But it also gives them some responsibility. And that is to act like Christ. So we have confidence in the Lord. But the second thing we have in this culture of trust is a kind of a competence. It makes us a kind of a can-do people. It doesn't matter what we face. It doesn't matter how big the challenges are to fix the sewer pipe. We can do it. We can do it when we decide this is what God wants us to do. We can do it. when it means we have to forgive our brother who has harmed us and made us feel like victims and run us off. We can do it. We can give pardon. We can do it. Paul discovered it and claimed it to the Corinthians when he said, I can do all things through Christ. It must have been a great surprise to be able to announce that. This man had been beaten and run out of town and called every name in the book a charlatan, a fake. And yet, he said, I don't care what you call me. I'm just going to tell you what I've discovered. And that is that in Christ, I can do all things who gives me strength. It's the fulfillment of exactly what Christ announced when he said, stick with me. Stick with me. Live through me. Find my way. And whatever you ask in my spirit, my heavenly Father will do it for you. And that's change. When you start thinking like that, you are a changed person. There's a confidence in your life that's different, and there's a competence in your life that's different. We get out there and we are can-do people. We can do it. We can do it. This is the culture of trust. This is the change. And after that change comes in our lives, our attitudes need to change. Our likes and our dislikes change. The things that we think we have to get by, we lose a taste for them. We have a spirit of wanting to help. We have an outstretched hand instead of a gripped, hold it close to the vest kind of hand. We have a sense of devotion that if the Lord asks it of us, I will try. We have a sense of the ability to make a promise and keep it. We found out that it's better to give our whole selves, our time, and our talents, our energies, and our treasures. But admittedly, it comes slower for some of us than it does for others. Sometimes we get this meaning of salvation all backwards. Sometimes we think to accept that there is a God somewhere puts us on good footing with God. Somehow we think that if we have just a general, you know, moral approach to life, that we're not going to hurt anybody, we're not going to put up with any kind of hurts out there, that makes us on the good side with God. But nothing is further from the truth. The truth of what God wants is a people that he can call his own. Let me tell you the way Brennan Manning wrote about it. He's the author of the Ragamuffin Gospel, and he said it this way: the splendor of a human heart that trusts and knows that it's loved unconditionally gives God more pleasure than all the bells of Westminster Cathedral, all of the images on the Sistine Chapel, all of the melodies of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, all of the covers in Van Gogh's Sunflowers, all of the miracle of the sight of 10,000 butterflies bursting into flight, or the scent of a million orchids in bloom. Trust is our gift back to God. It gives God more pleasure than anything else in creation when he finds someone that trusts him. He finds it so enchanting that Jesus died for the love of it. Salvation means change. A total, complete makeover. C-H-A-N-G-E. If anyone is in Christ, they're a new creation. They're different. They're completely remade. They think different. They act different. They walk different. They look different because they are different. The fruits of our lives are not the way that we get into God's life. But the fruits of our lives do prove whether God is God in our lives or not. Salvation means change. And that's what the scripture's saying to us. If you have trusted your life to Christ and haven't run back and snatched it back again, you are a new creation. Oh, you may stumble a time or two. You're going to fall down and smack your face on the pavement hard as life. You're going to have somebody pick you up from time to time. But you are a new creation. Changes come in different ways, I don't think. The first change is in you. Now, every generation comes along and cries out that the church needs to change. But let me say to you, the first change that happens is in the hearts of people. And then they get into church, and then the church changes. That's how churches change, by people's hearts that are changed. Change is never a destination that a church somehow can one day arrive at. Change is a journey. Because God is always in the work of changing people's lives and opening up closed relationships and helping tongues to confess that indeed, He really is in charge here. And it's not all up to me. There's so much change going on in church all the time. Annie Dillard, the Pulitzer Prize winner, said that when we enter church, we ought to be buckling our seat belts and putting on crash helmets. Change in church is constant. If God's going to be making a family out of strangers, then there's a whole lot of change constantly going on right underneath our very noses. I had a good friend named Chuck who was a deacon in one of my former churches. And he had a tough time physically. His wife had been a faithful encourager and wonderful mother to his children and always standing by him in his ups and downs in business and so on. One day he just got a whole new idea. He walked into his parents' home and he said, "I want a divorce. I want to go out on my own. I just want to be responsible for me for a change. Just me alone." His mother, Evelyn, was nearing 90 years of age, and she quietly turned to him and she said, "You need to think that through again, buddy. We don't do things like that in this family." When God built a kingdom on this earth, it's a group of people that love each other enough and stay close enough to each other that sometimes we say, "We don't do things like that in this family." And after the first change is made in the hearts of people, and the church changes because people's hearts are changed, then the world starts changing. Because you see, that's God's plan, to change the world. Through you and me, through this congregation, and that one across the street, and that one up on the hill, and that one up in Montreal, and that one over in Korea. It's the leaven in the loaf, remember? God spoke about it. It's the salt that saves that hunk of ham, that preserves it. That's God's plan. To change your heart, and then your church, and then your world. We might be afraid of change, but it is the reason that Jesus came to this earth. Salvation means change. Some of us think it's a ticket to heaven. It means a menu for change. You start off with your appetizer, then you go to the main course. And then you go from there to a little dessert. And then you can sit around and have a lot of good conversation as you have wherever you finish up your meal with. Salvation means change. And the world, this world, is dying to have a people among them so brave that they know who created this world and why, and they know how to bring about change. You know, one
A church stands for change. That's why we're here. We live for it. We live to create such an environment that God can bring about changes. When we find ourselves resistant to change, we need to be on our knees, searching for what God wants. A church lives for change because the redeeming love of God one day will bring justice to all of this earth and will bring mercy to all the peoples of this earth and will help all of us know how to walk humbly with our God. Change, though, starts with your heart and your mind. There's a famous prayer. We need to be inspired by it more often. And when change comes, we begin to say a prayer like this. Lord, I want to be an instrument of your peace. I've seen enough hate. Help me to sow love. I've seen so much injury I can't stand it. Teach me how to get pardon. I've seen the doubts around us that just stop things and the wheels grind to a halt. Give me a way to plant the seeds of faith. Lord, I've seen so much despair in the faces of people. Help me know how to share hope. I've seen darkness that just seems to ruin people's lives. Help me know how to share life. I've seen so much sadness. Help me to share joy. Help me, Lord, not so much seek to be understood as to understand. Not so much to seek to be consoled, but to learn how to console another. Not so much to seek to be loved myself, Lord. Teach me how to love. Because I trust you. I trust you that in giving, I receive. And that in pardoning, I get your pardon. And that in dying, I'll be born.
Our time of invitation is not just a routine part of our Worship is an opportunity to stand and sing a song of commitment and hope, and it may be an opportunity for you to give your life to Christ. I stand in front and I receive those who make decisions, who want to be a part of a church, that wants to come alive and have a vital and strong faith, that strong witness. I also stand here for those who just simply want to say, I need Christ in my life. So I stand here to receive you come with a decision in your heart. We stand and sing together.
Thank you.
summer Sundays, that this would be the time, one of the last Sundays we gather together at the front for our benediction. We're doing this for the sense of feeling the real community that we are in Christ. And we are a community now set on an interesting path. We are in the search for God's pastoral leader for this church. So would you come now forward for this benediction?
Picked out for us if we can just follow your leadership and